When we think about chemistry and chemists, we immediately imagine lab coats, some weird instruments with fancy colored liquids inside, big molecular crystals, and chemicals whose smell is not always pleasant. All of this is of course true, but there does exist a very different type of chemist, the theoretical chemist. The only thing a theoretical chemist does need is a computer. And with this computer, a theoretical chemist can simulate a whole range of chemical processes based on some mathematical formulations. For example, at the Institute of Theoretical Chemistry of the University of Vienna, a particular research interest is on the interaction of matter with light.
Light is powerful. It is the driving force of many chemical reactions that are important parts in all our daily lives, like photosynthesis, vision, the forming of skin alterations by the sun, photoluminescence, and many more. In order to learn more about these so-called photoreactions, we perform computer simulations. We want to figure out how molecules behave after being excited by light. Currently, such simulations can be computationally very demanding, so that it is often only possible to simulate a few hundred femtoseconds. In many cases, however, this is not enough. Therefore, we are working on speeding up the simulations of light-induced chemical reactions by employing efficient sampling methods that help to find the pathway the chemical reaction at hand follows, and by incorporating machine learning.
This all sounds nice, but how does understanding this does help me in coming up with a new experiment?
How do we go from sunlight to the reaction that leads to photosynthesis or damaging of a tumor? These cool intermediates between the light and our photochemical reactions are called photosensitizers. They are the light-absorbing molecules that will trigger a photochemical processes. Our work is to uncover the electronic properties of these molecules. But in order to do this, we need to disentangle what happens at the molecular level once a photosensitizer absorbs light. When we know the electronic properties of our photosensitizer, we can work on how to modify it so that we get others that are more efficient. The cool part is that we do all this through computer simulations.
A theoretical chemist can also focus on renewable energies.
We want to produce hydrogen for use as a green fuel. To do this, we look at nature. Trees use sunlight, water, and CO2 to produce oxygen and fuel their growth. On the molecular level, this process is called photosynthesis, and it takes place in a protein called photosystem II. We want to design an artificial protein made of functional polymers with a new kind of catalyst at its center. That catalyst will carry out a form of artificial photosynthesis, turning water into oxygen and hydrogen using sunlight. My job is to simulate the catalyst at the atomic level, to find out how it works and learn how it can be improved. My simulations allow me to watch the catalyst function in slow motion, so I can see what is happening at every step of the reaction.
Additionally, a theoretical chemist can investigate the interaction of light with biological environments.
You might know the phenomenon of fluorescence from some animals or your last party before Corona. The effect comes from special molecules that first can absorb light, for example UV light, and second emit light again, but this time it is of a different wavelength than before. In these examples here, it is then green, blue, or red light. This property of fluorescent dye molecules is an important tool for researchers in fluorescence microscopy. The goal in my research is to understand the fluorescence mechanism of known dyes for this type of microscopy and optimize the properties of new dyes. I concentrate on fluorescent dyes for ion channels and transporters, which are important proteins for the communication between cells in the central nervous system. To understand what is going on in the central nervous system is the key in finding better treatment for complex disorders like depression, Alzheimer's, or ADHD, to just name a few.
A theoretical chemist can also investigate the damage light does to the genetic code that's within ourselves.
DNA is the most important molecule in our life. It's actually the molecule at the basis of our life. We started to know how DNA looks like in 1951, when the first picture of a DNA was taken. Nowadays, we have a broad knowledge about DNA and about its physical and chemical properties. But it still remains a hot field of research, due to its implication in chemistry, in material science, in biology, and in medicine. Indeed, the damage of DNA can represent a very big risk for our health. DNA is composed by four constituents, molecules called nucleobases: adenine, thymine, guanine, cytosine. This molecule can be the site of a DNA damage. For example, we can have thymine dimerization. We can have some epigenetic damage of cytosine. We can have an oxidative damage of guanine. And this can be the case of several diseases. As a theoretical chemist, we can help the research with methods like molecular dynamic simulation. In particular, we can investigate chemical systems over time. We can calculate chemical and physical properties. We can calculate the interaction with other molecules like enzyme, protein, drugs. And after hours, days, weeks, sometimes months of simulation on our computer, we actually have our result. We can see our molecules dancing, and we can obtain the information we were looking for.
But the question remains, how does a theoretical chemist does look like at work?